good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Today is the day that the Lord has made. And I don't know about you, but I am so happy to be here. I'm so grateful to be in His presence to praise Him. We invite you to stand as we sing our intro. Hallelujah. Come before His presence with thanksgiving. Hallelujah, right here. Say, come before. Come before His presence with thanksgiving, and just say, enter into His heart with praise, and be thankful unto Him. Say, and be thankful unto Him, for He is worthy.
Just one person. Happy Sabbath, everyone. The Bible says, I was glad that it said unto me, let's go into the house of the Lord. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? If you're happy, I just want you to stand to your feet and give the Lord a hand praise and thankfulness. And while you're standing on your feet, just give a fist bump to the person next to you and say, happy Sabbath. We're glad you're here this morning to worship with us. Happy Sabbath. Amen, amen. We serve a good God, don't we? He woke us up this morning, we're in our rightful minds, and we're here this morning. He protected us all week from danger seen and unseen. And here we are to worship Him and to give Him the praise that's due to His holy name. And so I want to thank you so much for coming into the physical space this morning with us. And for those of you who are watching online, I say happy Sabbath. You should have been here. Quite frankly, are you in agreement with me? It's so nice to be in the house of the Lord with our brethren sitting beside us. And so I want to thank you so much for coming into the house of worship this morning. For those of you who are worshiping with us and you're celebrating a birthday, I want to say happy birthday. I know Sister Daphne, where are you at? Sister Daphne. Let's give her a hand. Sister Daphne, she's having a birthday today. And you want to say happy birthday. Anybody else in the house that's celebrating a birthday? Who is? Oh, my brother, Stan, let's give him a hearty happy birthday as well. Thanks for coming. If you're visiting with us for the very first time, I want to say welcome to Mississauga Church. This is the place to be. There's no other place like this place. If you're having an anniversary celebration, let me see you raise your hands today. You're celebrating an anniversary. No? Okay. You just celebrated. Just you happen to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Okay. I just wanted to remind us that our mission statement today says that we're to proclaim Christ's love so that all will be saved. And what does our vision say? It says to connect, grow, serve, and inspire. And that's the reason why we're here this morning. So I want to thank you so much on behalf of the officers and members of this church for coming out. I want to invite you to just keep coming. Keep worshiping with us. You know, the world is in a state right now where everybody's doing everything else. But there's no place like worshiping in the house of the Lord. Do you agree with me? So I want to say to you, happy Sabbath. And you have so much in store for you this morning. So please come again and invite your friends next week. Don't come alone. Happy Sabbath.
Sabbath. God is good, and all the time, God is good. This psalmist declares that I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. For when I think of the goodness of Jesus and what he has done for me, my heart cries out, hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. Left side, has God been good to you? Let me hear you say it. God is good. Amen. Right side, has God been good to you? Let me hear you say it. God is good. Amen. Here are a few announcements on behalf of our pastoral team. We are going into the winter season. The flu virus is on the rise, especially among our children, causing respiratory complications and a high level of fever. That is life-threatening. Canada medical doctors are predicting another possible COVID-19 outbreak for the winter season that is fastly approaching. So I implore you that as you go about your daily activities, please ensure that you are doing so within the health and safety guidelines to ensure our children are safe, our loved ones are safe, and our friends are safe. Yesterday, November 11, 2022, was Remembrance Day. Each year, we observe this day, remembering the courage and dedication of our young men and women who made extraordinary sacrifice, many of whom paid the ultimate price, so we can enjoy the freedom we have today. Let us continue to remember these warriors who bravely and honorably defended peace and freedom. It is also a very sad day for the Mississauga Seventh-day Adventist Church, as our beloved sister, Christina Brissett, has lost her dad. She is now in St. Lucia making preparation for the funeral. We will remember her and her family in prayer. Christina Brissett, if you're watching online now, just know that you have our full support here at the Mississauga Seventh-day Adventist Church. Also, I want to remind those in the sanctuary and those who are watching online that are in need of prayer that we have a prayer team here readily waiting in one of our prayer rooms. Just indicate and someone will be there to assist you. I want to encourage everyone to be hopeful despite of what is going on in our world. Continue to trust in God and you will mount over your problems. You will mount over your difficulties. You will mount over your storm, coming out stronger than valiant heart, who to your glory came through dust of conflict and through battle flame. Tranquil you lie, your knightly virtue proved, your memory hallowed in the land you love. Proudly you gathered rank on rank to war. As who heard has had heard God's message from afar. All you had hoped for, all you had you gave to save mankind, yourselves you scorned to save. Sir John Stanhope Arkwright penned these words as part of a poem published in a book of poetry appropriately entitled The Supreme Sacrifice and Other Poems in Time of War. The poem, 7 verses, was set to music and has been sung since then as a hymn remembering the fallen of the First World War. Yesterday, we remembered as a country those who served. Today, we as a church community will remember that those who served and those who continue to serve very often pay for the freedoms we enjoy with all they had. Freedom. Now there's a word we don't necessarily think about often. We just assume we have it and go about our business. We almost never consider what our lives would be without it. And paying the supreme sacrifice for it seems so far removed from our daily reality. Yet, without their sacrifice, without them giving their all, life as we know it would be vastly different from what we have today. Freedom, that concept not in the forefront of our minds, would be but a hope and a longing. So today we will stand together for a moment of silence, contemplation, and remembrance. We will honor those in our community who served. So we honor you, Anson Raymond. We honor you, Peter Mosey. We honor you, Charles Grant. We honor you, Laszlo Szabo. And anyone else among us or hearing today who has served or who is currently serving, we honor you and we thank you for all you gave and what you continue to give. May we stand together for 30 seconds of silence to honor those who have served and who are serving.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Are you glad to be here this morning? Yeah. Okay, I'm going to tell you a story about a young girl. And let's call her Janet. Let's call her Janet. So Janet lived in a country called Jamaica, an island. And everybody knows, have you ever been to Jamaica? Yeah, you've been to Jamaica? Oh dear, nice. So you've been to Jamaica. So she was born in Jamaica, actually. But you know, there was something about Janet. She was so contrary. She would always, if her grandmother said to her, walk there, she would walk the other way. If we said to her, don't eat that, she would eat it. At school, if the teacher said the sky was blue, Janet would say, no, 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 the sky is pink. She was always giving trouble. To the point where at church, Janet wouldn't pay attention. The pastor would be preaching, and Janet would be having her own sermon with her friends. And so one day, it got so bad that there was Janet in church having her own conversation. She was handing out candies to her friends. She was talking to her friends. They were laughing and giggling. And the pastor had to stop the sermon. Can you imagine? Wouldn't that be embarrassing? Yeah, the pastor had to stop the sermon to say, Janet, be quiet. We're in the house of the Lord. You have to be reverent. And so Janet, so what happened after that was very epic. They decided that they were going to have a meeting about what to do with Janet. And so they had a board meeting. And so these members got together, and the board of elders got together, and the deacons got together, the deaconesses got together, and they're like, Pastor, we have to do something about this young lady. She's 12 years old, but she's very disruptive. So the pastor said, I have a good idea. What do you think the idea was? Any thoughts? Pray to the Lord. Oh, yes. The pastor prayed to the Lord for her. But then the pastor also had another idea. He said, you know what? If that sister, Janet, wants to give so much trouble, let's put her in charge of something. And so the pastor decided to make her the leader of the AYS. You know what AYS is? Like the Adventist youth. Like, you know, AYS. It's an evening service where the young people come out. And so the pastor decided to have her in charge of that. And you know what happened when the pastor decided that? Sister Janet decided to bring all her friends. And so they put on a program. And from that day forward, she was well-behaved because she wanted to make sure she'd give a good example in church. And Sister Janet got all her friends. They were in the baptismal class, and before you know it, they all were baptized. And they started to praise the Lord, and they were reverent in church. So the moral of the story is today, boys and girls, that when we come into the house of God, in the house of worship, we have to be reverent, because the Bible says, reverent my sanctuary. Are we in agreement with that? So what does that look like? What does reverence look like? Any ideas? What does it mean to be reverent?
Helpful and be nice. To listen to the pastor and be careful at church.
To listen to the pastor, to be careful at church. Anybody? Any ideas what reverent means? That's a good idea. Don't step on people's toes. You don't want to step on people's toes in church. So we want to be reverent when we come into the house of the Lord. So that what that means is you're going to be listed attentively and paying attention and make sure when you're on your way home with your parents, just remind them of what the pastor said. Okay? Because you're reverent, so you heard every word. Are we going to be reverent to church today? Let me see those who want to be reverent. Yanni, do you want to be reverent today in church? Yeah, you got to be reverent to church today. Amen. Who wants to pray for us? Want to pray for us?
God, help us be nice. Don't let any be hurt, and we will be nice to others. Don't let any step on the toes, and everybody be nice to each other. Amen.
Anybody else wants to pray? One more prayer. Who wants to pray? One more prayer? No? We're good? Okay. Have a happy Sabbath, everyone.
Brought us to an auto meet, dear Lord, and we are so grateful. Dear Lord, so we're here to say thank you. Despite the week we had, dear Lord, some of us had sadness, some of us joy, but we're here to praise you anyways, because you have kept us. And so, Father, we just want to give you all the honor, the glory, and the praise. Father, before we speak, you already know our thoughts. So we just want to say thank you for many blessings that you have heaped upon us. Prayer requests that will go out to you today, dear Lord. I know you're already on the job, taking care of the needs of our people. Father, we just want to bless our congregation as we return to your sanctuary from the pandemic, dear Lord. Their prayers requests will go out for healing, for sickness, from sickness and dear Lord, and various requests will come to you, dear Lord, but we know you are our Lord and our receive it. You promise, you just said, just ask, and it shall be given according to your will, dear Lord. So I just want to thank you. Father, your world is dying. This world is a dying world, dear Lord. So there's so much things going on. Disaster, natural disasters, hurricane, flood, tornadoes in diverse places of this world, dear Lord. And as we, your people, traverse, dear Lord, we look to you and no other, because we know that enemy, the devil, Satan, is there, dear Lord. He's like lion seeking to destroy your children. But we know we speak to you first, and you are there to take care of us, dear Lord. Father, we remember the folks in the Ukraine and Russia at this time, as we see autocrats trying to impose their will on your people, dear Lord. But we know you have the control, and the devil, he knows his time is short, dear Lord. So he's trying to put on all stuff, but I know all this will come to an end when you will be no more. Father, we just want to thank you. Father, you have a word for us today. And I know that this word will go out to your people. And we are, you know, just ask you to bless the speaker who will bring this word to us, dear Lord, because this is needed in this dying world where, you know, a lot of folks have left the sanctuary and the congregation and gone doing other things, dear Lord. But I know you are standing at the door, dear Lord. You're knocking. Just for them to open, so you can come in and have a restoration. So, Father, we just want to thank you for all that you will do, all that you're doing, and all that will do in our hearts. Let there be a revival for your words coming out today, dear Lord. So, souls will be impacted, life, souls will be won for you, dear Father. We just want to say thank you for these end of verses we ask in your precious name. Amen.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. So what a privilege, what a privilege it is to God is a great God, and I don't know about you, but I've come to bless his name this morning. Is anybody ready to join me in praise and worship to our God? We are the embracing group, and we're so grateful to be here worshiping with you. We thank you so much for the invitation, and we invite you wherever you are, whether you're watching online, whether you're here in the sanctuary, we invite you to sing with us this morning. The song says, let people praise. We have come to give him praise, the Ancient of Days. Hallelujah, he's the Holy One. So we say hallelujah, hallelujah. Just put your hands together like this. Just put your hands together. Very, very simple song. Just call and response. Coming in right here. Simply have come to give praise. You are all the emotions of days. Simply have come to give praise. You are the only one.
Hallelujah. So you believe me up inside. The King of Healing, the King
King of power, the King of prosperity to fill this place this morning. Hallelujah. Does anybody want his reign on you this morning? I know I want it. The song says,
yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King.
Hallelujah.
So let's start right now. What would we wait? King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you.
Count if you don't sing it.
Say, King of glory, fill this place. I just want to be with you. I just want to be with you.
Say, yes, Lord. Say, well, bow down.
Bow down and say you are God.
Say, every man, every man.
Say, well, bow down.
And see that you are King.
So let's start right now. I just want to be with you.
fellowship according to grade 12 math. I don't like math. People could identify. I was never good at math. It was not my thing. But in order to get into university, I needed two advanced math courses. And I would be, I'm going into the healthcare field and I'm thinking, why on earth do I need to know how to do math if I'm going to be in healthcare? Only to come to realize later that the whole world is run on equations and math. But at the time, I could care less for math. My plan was, if I need it, I am going to do all that I can just to pass the course. You know what I'm saying? I knew enough math to be able to calculate the average that I would need to keep my marks up so that I can get into the university of my choice. And so I did the math and said, yes, this is what I would need. And so I did not study. I went to class, and this is my approach to math. I'd walk in and I would say, sir, is this going to be on the test? And if it's not going to be on the test, I don't need to study it, right? So this is my approach. They never asked the question, but I came across something that said, if a teacher repeats something often enough, right, Anton? If they repeat it often enough, it's going to be on the exam. So the light bulbs went on in my head, and I said, pay attention to that, because what they say is what you need to know. And that's all I wanted. Just give me the basics, what I need to know. So I paid attention to that. And so you could imagine how excited I was when I was introduced to the concept of the cheat sheet. Anybody know what a cheat sheet is? Cheat sheet. You're given a piece of paper, a legal size paper, to take into an exam with whatever information you feel is necessary to help you pass this exam. So, with my brilliant idea that only tuning into what I need to know, and now I have this cheat sheet, I got this, right? I'm gonna ace this exam. Well, I'm gonna pass it as much as I need to pass to get the marks that I want. So here I was, I got my cheat sheet, and I started to write, and not with those orange, yellow HB pencils with the round tip, because that takes up too much space when you're writing. I got me a mechanical pencil with a fine point, and every piece of spare page that I could find on this cheat sheet. I wrote down equations. I copied half the textbook on the front side, and on the other side, I had it all written down so that when I go into the exam, I would have access to all the information I needed. Trust me, when you looked at my cheat sheet, you needed a magnifying glass to find stuff on that paper. So I go into the, getting ready to go into the exam. But I want to give you my first point. Point number one. You gotta open the book regularly. Okay? So, because I'm not interested in math, because I have no intentions of acing this, I got involved in other extracurricular activities besides studying for math, because I don't need to. I have this backup system that's going to take me where I
the basketball games after school. I tutored after school for other things. I went to the mall for hang out with my friends. I did everything. Oh, I did look at my math book. Yes, I did. I had to look at my math book. But I didn't look at it that often because I had something to fall back on. So, you can imagine where this is headed, right? Didn't touch my book. Had my cheat sheet with everything written down on it. And I tuned into what I needed to tune into so I get to the exam. I am good. I am set. And I am sitting there, ready, cheat sheet in hand. When you talk about opening a book, a true disciple, if you really want to follow somebody, and there's a difference between a follower of Jesus and a disciple of Jesus. Today in our culture, we have the terms, I'm following so-and-so on Twitter, and I'm following this person on whatever platform they're on. You're following, and a follower only goes after the person for what they can get, right? I'm following Barack Obama's Twitter page because he's on Barack Obama's Twitter page. I must be somebody who's important. So I want to be seen in those groups, and I want to be seen associated with those people. So I follow them, and as soon as I get the status that I want, and as soon as I get what I want, I'm no longer interested in following you. I move on to the next thing. Disciple, on the other hand, they're not in it for me. They're in it for their master. Because somebody for me, somebody who came and cleaned me up inside, somebody who brought me from the dregs of this world. I'm interested in that person, somebody who can still see my mess and still accept me. That's the person I want to follow. And I follow that person through thick and thin. And sometimes discipleship costs something because you have to give up something in order to be a disciple of Christ. Sometimes you gotta give up some friends. Sometimes you have to give up some pastimes and habits because you want to be like your master. So you spend time with them. You read the Word of God and you get to know what Jesus is like. And you say, I want to be like that. And you do what he does. You say what he says. You hang on every word of your master. But when I was in school doing math, I couldn't care about studying or hanging on anybody's word. And so, I am here with the exam. And they give it to me. And I take it. And I feel that, yes, this. And I could remember that day as if it happened yesterday. Because the trauma, I still feel it to this day. So, I look at the page, 5 pages. I can't get it out of my psyche, 5 pages. You know, when you have the exam, you go through and see what you got so that you know what you have to devote a lot of time to and what you don't have to devote a lot of time to. So I look at the exam, page 1. Nothing. Page 2. Still nothing. Through page 3. Nothing. Page 4. Nothing. Panic. sizes?
1,000.
What percentage would you say, or would you think, own a Bible?
60.
Okay. 80%.
25.
95. 8% of Americans in that poll own a Bible. Okay, so tell me, out of that 88%, how many actually read the Bible? 88% own a Bible. 88% of the 1,000 people they polled admitted to owning a Bible. How many of them actually read the Bible they own? 5%? 10%? 30%? 2%? Can I get an 8? Can I get a 6? Can I get a 27? Actually, 37% of them said they read the Bible. 37 read the Bible. How many times do you think they read the Bible, that 37%? Once a week. And the majority of them read that Bible once a week in settings like this, when they're in church and the Bible is being read to them. Okay, the ones who do say they might read the Bible other than these settings, they admit to reading a few sentences of the Bible once a week. Or they admit to reading a couple of stories from the Bible once a week. If you want to be like somebody, if you are in a relationship with somebody and you want that relationship to go somewhere, how much time do you think you have to spend with that person? Once a week? Once a week, just listening to a couple of sentences. Hey, girl, what's up? I like you and everything. Talk to you next week. Is that how it works? It doesn't cut it anywhere else. So why, as disciples, we think or we feel that I just need to read, this when we get to church, right? And the pastor's coming over, so take out the Bible and put it on the coffee table so that they know or they feel that you read the Bible. These are some of the shenanigans we do. We know that, right? But if you really want the change, you've got to open the book and find something that says, change me, clean me up inside, make me a different person. So I'm getting nothing from this exam. Nothing looks familiar. Nothing is resonating with me. No acronyms we use to kind of help us remember things. None of that was showing up. And I think, I'm so dead. And you know, I look up and I see my teacher. And you know how they have to walk around to make sure nobody's cheating? The teacher's walking around, he's got this big smile on his face as he is looking at all of these overcrowded cheat sheets. Because how many of you know a cheat sheet is only good if you know the material, right? If you don't know the material, you're useless meat. Because it's useless when you have to find information on a cheat sheet using a magnifying glass. When you are under pressure, it's like, where did I write this, right? That is not the time. The use of a cheat sheet is to be like a backup, a buffer. Just in case you forgot it, here is the information that you were looking for. It's not a starting point for your exam to get the information. And so I started to fret, and I started to panic, and the text came to mind in Timothy, 2 Timothy yourselves approved unto God, a watchman who needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. If you don't study, if you don't open a book and study, you know, there's a text that Jesus told his disciples as well to. He said, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are those that testify of me. John chapter 5 verse 39, I believe, says that. Searching means that you are looking carefully. You are looking thoroughly. Studying implies that you're not just flipping pages, but you are actually trying to understand what it is that you are reading and what it is that you are seeing. So, I was thinking, in the middle of this exam, when I am just melting because I don't know what I'm doing, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing, and you hear the rustling of papers, right? Because all the smart students, they're on page 2 or page 3. I haven't even begun this yet. And I'm starting to feel the pressure of this. And you know, I came across this article once that talked about college entrance exam in China. It is so grueling to go into college in China that they have what they call professional exam takers. It's illegal. And if you get fined, if you got found out, you can be in prison for up to 7 years. But because they know once you get into college, your career, your life is pretty much set, because you are on the way to success, that they would hire these people to take an exam for a student. And what they do is they will take a picture of themselves, and they will take your demographic information, and they would put it on this student ID card so that you can get in, they can get into the exam, impersonating you, write the exam, ace the exam, and your student, your child, gets to go to college like that. It has gotten so bad that the government has given them support to do fingerprinting and retinal scans so that you cannot fake it in the system. That's how I felt. Can somebody come and write this exam for me? Because I have no clue what I'm doing. And as disciples and as Christians, there's going to come a time when we have to take a test, when we have to stand before God. And he says, you know, you are going to have to stand before me and give an account to your own salvation. Not what you heard Sister Sherry say on the pulpit on Saturday. Not what you heard the pastor say. Not what you interpret somebody else as saying. And you know, we have this way of saying, I can't get into all that Bible stuff. I'm too busy. Life is too busy. I don't have time. And so you know what we do? We go and we get the Bible app. Who has the Bible app here? I have the Bible app. It's not a shame to have the Bible app. How much time do you spend on the Bible app? Does it prompt you to go and read your Bible? Because the 5 minutes that the majority of the people are spending on a Bible app to say, yep, tick it off, I did my devotional today and I'm good to go, it's not going to cut it when that exam time comes. You got to know your stuff. You got to know what's going on. You have to understand what you are reading and what you're seeing. Are you able to discern what's happening in our world even today? God says, Jesus says to his people, he says, you guys can sit here and you can discern when winter is coming, when the seasons are changing. Summer is here, discern the signs of the time. Why can't we? Because we don't know. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a watchman who can rightly divide the word of truth. So, getting back to my dilemma, there's nobody to rescue me, there's nobody to write this exam for me, I have no clue what I'm doing. I look at the page, and then I say, write something, anything, maybe you'll get some hard marks if you, and you know, on the exam paper, and then exams, they tell you, please show how you arrived at your answer. You see in those exams? You can't just put on the bottom, this is what I think it is. You have to demonstrate the steps that you took to get to where you're going. So I said, okay, read something, because you might be able to get some marks in one of the steps that would help you. Writing something, and then I look at the time and I see it's running out. This exam has some multiple choice questions. So I said, okay, leave that writing stuff, go to the multiple choice questions. Do you think that was any better? Multiple choice questions are designed to ensure that you know the subject matter, that you know the content, right? Because there are slight nuances, it changes. Listen, A was looking like B was looking like C was looking like D. Everything, there was nothing to say. Process of elimination, definitely. You know those ones, those absolutes that you look for in multiple choices, always and never, and you know, none of that. So, it's a good thing I read, because math was not my thing. So I read somewhere else, when in doubt, choose C. So, choose C. C, 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 C. That was my thing. I chose C. But how many of us know that C only works when it's a computer-generalized randomization? Because that's the only way you get true randomization. When a teacher is writing an exam, they don't know about the randomization process, so they put some. So that didn't work. And I felt like, okay, just get me out of here. If you come out of an exam and you feel like, you guys know what that means, right? It's like, I was duped. I was tricked. They didn't tell me that this cheat sheet, this stupid cheat sheet, it didn't do one ounce of support. It didn't help me in one iota. And so, I am coming out of the exam and thinking, that's it. I did a lousy job. I don't even want to think about it. But a true disciple never cuts corners. There's no cheat sheet when you're a disciple. You gotta get in there. You gotta see what the word says. And you gotta break it up. You know, the Bible says, when we study, when we read, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, put it together so you get the full picture. There's no quick, cold notes version when you want to become like Jesus. But I wanted an easy way out, because I really, really thought, I'm smarter now, but I wasn't so smart then. I really thought, how come this is not working for anybody? How come nobody else knows about this system, right? Just pay attention to what you need to pay attention to, and take your cheat sheet in there, and you're good. But you gotta understand the material. You gotta understand what you're doing. So I come out of the exam. You know, the results are going to come in at some point. Mercy. So, the results come out and they post them on the board. And all I can say is thank God for anonymity when you have a student number, that your whole business is not out there for everybody to associate Sherry and this particular mark. So it's posted. And I'm watching the kids approaching the board. I'm not there yet. Because when this happened, you know, when I walked out of that exam, at the end of exams, typically, you get to get up with your classmates and say, how'd you do? Did you get that question right? I dodged. I didn't want to see nobody. I didn't want to talk to nobody. I went nowhere. I just went and escaped very quietly. But now I have to face the music.
So let me tell you, I got my act together. And I cracked some books. Right? And this is where you find the smart kids in the class. Right? And you say, can I come and work with you guys? While they're doing their thing, so that some of that can rub off on you, so that you can get to be where I couldn't get to where they were, but it could have been better. This is where you start taking some notes. When you go to church, write something down. Open the book. Go ask some questions. Join a study group and say, did you understand? What do we talk about? All this means, and by that shared experience, you get some enlightenment, right? That will help you so that you are able to rightly discern the word of truth. Because we are living in a time of false theology and fake scriptures. You heard of fake news? There are fake scriptures. Fake scriptures like cleanliness is next to godliness. It's not in the Bible. Right? The Lord helps those who help themselves. It's not in the Bible. Right? Money is the root of all evil. It's not in the Bible. But you have to be able to pick up the slight nuances when people come and tell you theology, like, you know, there's something that happens to you when you die. You go towards the light. And my loved ones are looking down on me. I know it gives us comfort. But is it the Bible? Right? Matthew 24:24 says, false Christs and false prophets will arise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, the very elect. This is like the multiple choice of Christianity. Like it, but no, that's the deciding factor. That's a little nuance that tells you this is wrong, right? And for us to be able to pick up on that, we need to know what it says in the book. As disciples, we can't just be satisfied with somebody telling us this is going to happen and that's going to happen and this is what you believe. Fake scriptures and false theology is going to make us miss out so close, but so close doesn't cut it. And so we have to study to understand and see what God is saying to us. And I got my act together. You know why I got my act together with math? Because it was important for my academic future. Discipleship is about your spiritual future. Where are we going when we come and we congregate every week? What is the point of this? Right? We are just fooling ourselves, because a day is coming when we're going to get sussed out. And somebody's going to be able to tell, yeah, you didn't study, did you? You didn't get this, did you? And so we don't stop wasting our time. And so when we talk about discipleship, you know how it said? I used to ask the question, is this going to be on the test? I just want to say, I don't ask that question anymore. Because whatever I engage in, whether it's English or math or studies or know the material, get to know it, because discipleship is not going to be on the test. Discipleship is the test, right? By your works, people will know it, who you are spending time with. And if your life is wrapped up in Jesus, you can't hide that. Everybody will know. We will love like Jesus loved. We will walk like Jesus walked. We will talk like Jesus talked. We will live like Jesus lived. We will be like Jesus. That is the evidence of discipleship, when the world can look and know by our walk and our talk and our actions who we have been
of the exam, the teacher's going to say, put your pencils down. Where will we be? Where will I be? You know, it's good to talk. It's good to talk, but you have to be consistent. Talk and walk, they go together. And you have to ask yourself the question, what's occupying my time? What's making me so busy that I can't get into this word that's going to help my future as a disciple? It will be the deciding factor on where I am going. And I'm not here to anybody. I'm just saying, if we want to be disciples, if we want to live right, if we want eternity to be our destination, our final destination, we got to change some things up. There's still chance for us to get our acts together. And so I want to ask you today, what kind of disciple are you? Are you the cheat sheet kind of disciple that you cut corners and you look for somebody to tell you what they think you need to know versus what the scripture tells you? Search the scripture. That's what Jesus said. That's what he told his disciples. Search the scripture. In them you have eternal life because they testify of me. If you want to know Jesus, you've got to spend time in the book. Or are you a multiple choice disciple, right? Going through a guessing game in your spiritual walk. Maybe it sounds kind of right. That sounds kind of right. We've got to stop. We need to become disciples that are note-taking, study group attending, reading the word, and going out there and sharing with somebody else. And if I can just get in closing, can you just put up the scripture reading for me again one more time? This is Luke 10. Can you put up that scripture reading? And I want you to really focus on what Jesus is saying. And behold, a certain congregation member from Mississauga Seventh-day Adventist Church stood up and tested him, saying, "Teacher, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said, "What does the scripture say? What is written in the word? And what is your reading? What is your understanding of it?" And he said, "You shall love the Lord your God." Yeah, I know that. "With all your heart." Yeah, I know that. "With all your soul." Yeah, I know that. "With all your strength." "With all your mind." "And love your neighbor as yourself." Yeah, I know all that. And Jesus says, "You spoke rightly." Yes, you got it right. Now, go and do this, and you will live. And so I'm just encouraging you today. I am imploring you today. What does the scripture say? You can't know what the scripture says unless you actually go into the scripture. How do you read it? How do you understand it? You can't read it unless you are asking some questions. You can't understand unless you ask some questions. You compare some things. You go to put up your hand and ask for clarification. Go to a study group. And when you finish, go and do it. So I pray that we are disciples who read the word. We are disciples who understand the word. And we are disciples who will do the word and live by the word. It's my prayer for each and every one of us today. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Christian, and I'm not going to ask you to come up to the altar.
their tithes and offering and monetary gifts online. Visit the Mississauga Seventh-day Adventist Church.com and you can remit your tithes and offering and monetary gifts there. If you have credit card or debit card, you can make a point of sale transaction in our administrative office. You can also do e-transfer at Mississauga Church Group at AdventistOntario.org. As our worship experience comes to an end, I want to remind you immediately after divine service, we have Sabbath School online. There is also Sabbath School in the church at 9:30 a.m. every Sabbath morning. Originally, it was 10 a.m., but several requests were made to have the time changed. So I invite you all to come out in your numbers and have a wonderful time. Our youth school class meet in the music room each and every Sabbath, and other classes meet at different locations on our church compound. So I invite you all to come out and support our Sabbath school.
I believe you are the God. Thank you.